I know a man who, he keeps all his money in a sock in his bedroom. He doesn't have a bank account. He doesn't have a checking account. It's all cash. He doesn't have any accounts on, he doesn't have an email, no social media. He wants to stay completely off the grid. Do you know anybody like that? Are you like that? Are you off the grid completely? There's a lot of arguments for and against that. I've heard a lot of people talk like that. But he doesn't trust banks. It's his money. And it's just going to be there when he needs it. And he just sits on it. And there's probably a lot of people like that. And like I said, there's a lot of arguments on either side. I can hear it. Some sounds pretty reasonable, the reasons why people wouldn't want to put their money in a bank. But we're going to look at today that when it comes to our service and our use of our gifts and talents and everything like that, God doesn't want us to stay off the grid. He doesn't want us to hide it away. He wants us to put it to use and give it out and let it grow. And so we're going to look at the parable of the talents. You might be familiar with this one. Jesus tells the stories of a man who goes on a journey, and he gives money to three of his slaves, and they give him different amounts, and then when he comes back, he wants to see what they did. And one guy was given five talents, and he made five more talents. Another guy was given two talents, and he made two more talents. Then the third guy, he was only given one talent, and he didn't do anything with it. He buried it in a hole, just like you see in the picture on the screen. He buried the money in the ground, and when the guy came back, the master came back, what the man had was the one talent he had given. He says, here, you can have that back. And so we're going to look at why that's bad. And so our main truth I want you to take away today is that believers ought to serve faithfully while we await Christ's return. This parable is told in the greater context of Jesus talking about his return, about the day of judgment, when God comes, the day of the Lord arrives, and everyone's going to be called to account on how they live their lives. He's been really hitting hard the Pharisees. Chapter 23, we only looked in Sunday morning at the first part of the chapter, but if you go and read the second part of the chapter, chapter 23, the woes, woe to you Pharisees, woe to you scribes. It's really harsh language. Jesus, who the world says was just he's our friend, he's our homeboy, and he's all about love. When you read what he says to the Pharisees, those warnings, we need to take that seriously. We got to make sure we don't fall into the same trap as the Pharisees. And so we have to understand that we have the last text we looked at last week. We saw that we had to be ready because we don't know when he's coming back. And he specifically talked about the moment he returns. What are you going to be up to? Are you going to be ready for the moment he returns? But now we're backing up. And so assuming that when he comes back is still far off, what do we do in the meantime? We're not just supposed to sit still and watch, although we are to be alert. But to be alert and to be watchful doesn't mean you just stand still and don't do anything. So we have to be busy working. So we have to be faithfully serving the Lord while we wait for him to come back. And I'm going to give you three reasons why this morning based on this parable. The first one is this: God entrusts his richest possessions to us. God entrusts his richest possessions to us. And you see that at the start of the parable, verse 14. It says, Jesus says, for it is just like. Now, what does that mean? He's talking about the kingdom. In the previous parable about the 10 virgins, he says the kingdom of heaven will be in the future. But now he says it's like this. It's just like a man about to go on a journey who called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To the one, verse 15, to the one he gave five talents, to another two, and to another one, each according to his own ability, and he went on his journey. Now, let me give you a little background on what a talent is. The talent was used in various ways. It was a weight, and it was generally about 80 pounds of silver. 80 pounds of silver. Some of you who've been watching the price of silver, I don't know what it is. What's it, like $15 an ounce or something like that? So you do the math on what 80 pounds of silver will be worth to you. But it was also used as a means of currency. A talent was 6,000 denarii. Now, do you remember from any of the studies what a denarius was? One day's wages. So 6,000 days worth of work. That's like 20 years. Now, how much have you made in the last 20 years? How much have you got left? Have you kept it all in a sock in your bedroom? No, you probably spent a lot. I don't have a lot to show for my last 20 years of work. I wish I did. But if you figure just minimum wage, what is it now, like 7 1/4? If minimum wage working an 8-hour day for 20 years, it's about $350,000. So that's one talent. And he gave five of those to one slave. Okay? And then he gave two to another, one to another. Now, why did he give more to this one, a little bit less, and even less to this one? Well, in the story, he says it was according to his own ability. Now, that's important for us, and it's important to me to hear that, and it should be important to you, because a lot of times when we look at each other and we compare ourselves to each other and we say, this guy, he's got more blessing, or this guy looks like he's not as blessed as me, and we begin to say, we begin to equate that with God's love. You got more because God loves you more. You got less because God loves you less. And where does that leave me? Does God love me less than this guy who's got more? Does he love me more than this guy has less? And if he loves this guy less, then do I not have to treat him as kindly as someone who God loves? You following me? But Jesus makes it very clear that the amount they were given was not based on the master's love for the slave. We can assume then he loved the slaves equally. And God loves you all equally. But he knows what you're capable of. And the master in the story knew what the slaves were capable of. After all, he'd watched them work. It wasn't because he loved one more than the other, but he knew what they were able to do. And so the man whom he gave five talents to, he knew he would do well with it. He knew he was capable of handling that much of his money. And the one who he gave two, he loved him just the same, but he didn't want to give him more than he could handle. He knew he could handle the two talents, so he gave him two instead of five. He didn't want to overwhelm him. Aren't you glad when he doesn't overwhelm you? Now, we've got this favorite saying we hear, one of these bumper stickers, right? God won't put more on you than you can handle. What verse is that? It's not a verse, right? The truth is, he does put more on us than we can handle sometimes. Why? So that we learn that we can't handle it. He handles it for us. Praise the Lord for that. I think our Sunday school lesson did a good job of illustrating that when Joshua was fighting all these men, and God helped them out. If God hadn't intervened with hailstones and lengthening the day, how do you think Joshua would have done in battle? It would have been tough. But God was there. It was more than Joshua could handle, and God had to intervene. And things happen in your life that are more than you can handle, and God intervenes and helps you. But still, every day, he knows what you're able to do. Now, in this story, the ability is all in the slave. The ability rests entirely in the slave, and the master gives the tools with which the slave can use his abilities. Now, in our thinking, our understanding of Christianity, we have much more, knowing that it's not just our abilities that we rely on. We rely on God's abilities, the help of the Holy Spirit, because we've all been promised that. In Jesus Christ, the Spirit indwells us, and the Spirit guides us, and the Spirit enables us and strengthens us. And so that makes it even much more better for us. It enriches our experience when we work for God, because he's entrusted the Spirit to us, and he's entrusted his wisdom and righteousness to us. He's given us so many things. He's given us the message of the gospel. He's given us eternal life, and he's given us he's put people in our sphere that we can influence for Christ, and we can mentor people, and we can influence people and guide them along. And that's a great responsibility for us. And I put this story right in the context of Jesus and his the way he's coming down on the Pharisees, because the Pharisees were responsible for guiding the Israelites in their spiritual growth, but they were failing miserable. In fact, in chapter 23, he says that in verse 13 of 23, he says, "You shut off the kingdom of heaven from people." That's the opposite of what they were supposed to be doing. They were supposed to be, show people the way to the kingdom, but they were closing the door. And he says, "You don't enter in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in." He also says in verse 15, he says, "You travel around on sea and land to make one proselyte, one convert, and when he becomes converted, you Pharisees make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves." That's tough. And that's sobering to think that if we're careless with the gospel, if we're careless with how we behave and teach, and we're careless about our example, the people that we think we've converted to Christ, brought into the church, we create a diversion and we take them far away from hell. And I don't want to be guilty of that. I know you don't. God help us that this should be a charge against us, that we've actually kept someone in trying to bring them into the church and into the family. We've actually kept them out of hell or out of heaven and destined them for hell. Woe to people who are guilty of that, and may it not be a charge brought against us. So he gives these gifts, he gives this money according to the ability of the slave. Verse 16 says, they immediately get to work. The one who had five, he went and he traded. He invested. He you know, it's like, you know, you start a business and you got product. You go and buy something at wholesale and you mark it up and you sell it and you got a profit. Simple, right? And so that's what he did. And so he was able to double the money. And the guy who had two, even though it was less than the guy with five, he still was able to make a profit. He doubled the income there. But then the third guy, the one who had just one, he dug a hole and he hid the money in the ground. And he thought that's all he had to do. He just had to make sure he didn't lose the money. And I think Christians are a lot like that way. We say, well, as long as I don't lose anything, as long as I don't do anything bad, you know. And that's the kind of questions the people ask Jesus in the Bible. Peter wanted to know, how many times do I have to forgive somebody? Because I don't want to hold a grudge too many times to keep me out of heaven. So if I've got to forgive somebody seven, I'm not going to forgive somebody eight, right? If seven's all it takes, seven's all you're getting. If ten commandments are all I got to follow, I'm not following the 11th. You got it? Kids are like that in school, right? Teacher's giving his lecture, that hand goes up, and believe me, this happened at Bible college too, okay? So it doesn't matter where you're a student, you've got the same mentality. Teacher's lecturing, hand goes up. Is this going to be on the test? Because I'm not writing it down unless you're going to test me on it later. And we treat our Christian walk that way. Are you going to bring this up on Judgment Day? Are you? Because I might watch what I do here. But if you're not gonna remember this on Judgment Day, then I know what I'm going to do. And so that's what this guy was like. He buried the talent, and he didn't do anything with it. Okay. So it's amazing to me that God entrusts us, because I know what I've done, and you know what you've done, you know where you failed, but God still loves you enough. He knows what you're capable of, and he doesn't give you too much more. And when he does give you more, he's there to help. And so when he gave the one guy one talent, he knew that guy, that servant was able to double that one so that when he returned, he would have two, but he refused to do it. He didn't give the guy one because he couldn't double it, because he knew he could. He probably couldn't have doubled two or five, but he could have doubled one, but he didn't. And so if you're moping around because you think, man, this hand I've been dealt is miserable, but just think, just be glad you got a hand at all. And God has given you this, you've been dealt this hand because he knows you can do something with what he's given you. And why aren't you doing it? He's entrusted you with this because he knows you can. And in those areas you can't, he will help you. Because that's how good our master is. And so, because he's entrusted us, he expects reasonable produce from us. Remember, he wants us to bear fruit. He wants results. And the results he wants are reasonable. He gave the man five. It was reasonable to expect him to double that, to make five more. He gave the man two. It was reasonable to expect him to make two more. When he gave the man one, it was reasonable to expect at least one more when he came back. And so we see that when the master came back in verse 19, he came and settled accounts. And the one who had received five came up. He brought five more, saying, Master, you entrusted five talents to me. See, I have gained five more talents. And the second slave in verse 22 says, You entrusted two talents to me. See, I have gained two more talents. And notice what he says to both of them. You can find it in verse 21 and 23. He says to them each, Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Enter into the joy of your master. He said to each of them, Well done, good and faithful servant. I think those are the words every one of us wants to hear when we see Jesus face to face. Do you want to hear those words from him? Well done, good and faithful servant. These two slaves, they were grateful that their master had entrusted these things to them, and they did not want to disappoint. And so they faithfully served. They used the tools provided to them, combined it with their own personality and abilities, and they saw results. They bore fruit, and their master was grateful. The same thing is true for us. God, he has rescued each one of you who believe in Christ. He's rescued you from sin. He's plucked you out of the world, and he's put you in his kingdom. He's transferred you into this glorious kingdom. You are new people, new creatures, and he's given you this inheritance that he's promised to you. He's given you the hope of eternal life, and he's given you gifts in the Spirit, and he's given you purpose. And I think we're all grateful for that, and we should be. It should change our outlook completely. I don't know what your life was like when you were still a sinner, how cynical you were, but that cynicism doesn't belong in the kingdom. You have a fresh outlook because you've got new life, new purpose, and you've got a God who loves you, not a God who deceived you like the devil. And so you work. You are good. You are faithful. And when God sees that you're faithful, we look ahead when the kingdom is a reality. When God is with us and he bestows his rewards on his servants. He says, you were faithful in a few things, you're going to be put charge in many things. Now, we don't understand entirely what that means. There's talk about judging nations and reigning over this and that. But even just to be included in the kingdom, when heaven comes down on earth, to be afforded the right to live there with God for eternity is enough for me. To think that he's going to give us even more than that, it just boggles the mind. But it gives us hope. It gives us purpose. And God expects this from us. When we live for ourselves, we do only that which gives us profit. When we have a skill and we think the way the world thinks, we say, I will share this skill only so much as it makes me profitable. It makes me rich, makes me famous. Whatever we do, we want to make a name for ourselves. But when we do it for God, we do it for His glory. See, the slaves who took the 5 talents and the 2 talents, they knew that this was never their money. It was the master's money. And they knew, he didn't lie to them. There was no deception here. They knew when he came back, he wanted to have it back. That never stopped them. And they did it with just as much joy and excitement to know that they were doing this for the glory of their master. And that's how we ought to be acting as Christians. Everything that we have is a gift from God. Our very life, our home, our family, it's all been given to us by God. We deceive ourselves when we think that we have done this. Like the rich fool that Jesus talked about, how he looked at how he had so much grain, his silos were filling up, he had no room left for his produce, so he was going to tear the old ones down and build bigger ones. And he said, look what I've done. It's a fool who thinks like that. And we don't want to be foolish. So we understand that it's all His, and we know God expects us to bring glory to Him through our actions. But it's reasonable. He's not harsh. He doesn't overwork us, which is what the Pharisees had done. They had overworked the people in their care, overworked them with man-made rules, overworked them. And they always had the sense that it was never enough. And we've got to understand this. This parable doesn't teach us that we're working for salvation. As if we don't have to live each day saying, have I done enough? We don't compare ourselves to the slave here. Have I done enough for God to let me in heaven? He just wants you to do your reasonable service. That's what Paul says in Romans 12. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, right? Don't be conformed to the world. Just do what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It's your reasonable service. If we just obey, it's not about the results. Maybe you've been given 5 talents and you've only made 4. But you did what you could do, right? Maybe you've been given 2 talents and right now you've only got 1 to show for it. 1 extra. But you were acting faithfully, obediently. It's not about the amount you produce. It's that you gratefully served Him. And that's the contrast between those 2 servants and the final servant. And we see another reason why we should serve faithfully, because when God comes, He will expel rebellious people from Himself. That's sad news, but it's a truth that we can't ignore. He will expel rebellious people from Himself. When He gets to the 3rd servant, verse 24, the one also who had received the 1 talent, came up and said, Master, I knew you to be a hard man. You reap where you did not sow. You gather where you scattered no seed. And I was afraid and went away and hid your talent in the ground. See, here's what is yours. Now that's interesting. The impression the servant had of his master, you're a hard man, you reap where you don't sow, you gather where you never scattered seed. Do you know anyone who that's their impression of God? Is God a hard God? Does God reap where he doesn't sow? Does he gather where he hasn't scattered seed? Do you find that to be true of God? Have you known anyone that's their attitude? That's their feelings of God. He takes what's not his. Could that ever be true of God? Is there anything that does not belong to him? That's the first question. What has God taken that was never his to begin with? There's not a thing. And I think if you start on that idea that there's something that's not God's, you've already started on the wrong foot. You've got the wrong foundation. And if in a person's heart you say, this is mine, not God's, then you're already in rebellion. His actions, too, are interesting. He says, I was afraid and went away and hid your talent. It takes me all the way back to the Garden of Eden. God came and he was looking for Adam and Eve. He couldn't find them. And Adam said, I was afraid and I hid. Because he was naked and ashamed. He thought God was keeping something from him. He was deceived by the serpent and felt that God was keeping something from him that should have been his, right? This knowledge is for me. This equality with God is for me to take. It belongs to me and God won't let me have it. I'm taking it. And when he did it, that's when man fell. And that's our condition. When we rebel against God, we think God is keeping what's ours from us. Or God takes what doesn't belong to him. But if we can come to the admission that everything belongs to God, then we can let go a little bit. We don't exert so much strength holding on to something that we might be asked to let go of. The master replies in verse 26. He says, you wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I did not sow. It's not an admission of guilt, but if that's your thinking, if this is how you see me, then your actions they're not even consistent with your thoughts. If you think this is how I am, then you should have still taken action and you didn't do anything. You were frozen in this rebellion. You didn't act. If in your mind I reap where I don't gather or don't sow and I gather where I don't scatter seed, then you should have taken my money and put it in the bank, put it with the money changers so that it could be collecting interest. You wouldn't have had to do anything except just let someone else do the work, and then I would still get money. And of course, you put money in the bank, and it gets interest. What have you done? It's just growing. So if he felt that's the way his master was, that's what he should have done. And the master is so angry in verse 20, he says, therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10. He says in verse 29, for everyone who has, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. That sounds like an oxymoron, doesn't it? He who doesn't have, even what he has shall be taken away. And how can you take away anything when he has nothing? When I read that, I think of just your life. The rebellious one who will not come around and be obedient to God, and he doesn't work for God. He has no produce. He's borne no fruit. He has nothing except his very life. He's got breath in his body. He's got a beating heart. He's thinking. He thinks he has nothing, but he has that. And God's going to take that. Because there must be a payment for sin. The Bible tells us without the shedding of blood, there is no remission, right? The wages of sin is death. And so this rebellious slave, he has to pay for his crime. And he has nothing with which he can pay for it, except his very life. And that'll be taken as payment. He says in verse 30, throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So he's been expelled from God's presence. Eternal separation from God. That is what rebellion gets a person. And you may not think about it as rebellion. You may just think, look, I'm just doing what's right by me. Well, when you do what's right by you and ignore what's right by God, that's rebellion. You're choosing to serve yourself over God. You're choosing to glorify self over God. And so we're called to something different. We're called to deny ourselves, to take up our cross, and to follow Christ. He has given us the tools. He's given us the ability. In fact, when we read the word talent, the reason talent is used the way it is today to refer to someone's gifts and abilities is because of this parable. And so he gives you talents, he gives you abilities, and he gives you things to do with those abilities. He gives you gifts of the Spirit. And so while we don't know when he's coming back, we're to be busy serving faithfully, remaining obedient, edifying people, building up the kingdom, drawing others into the kingdom, sharing the gospel. But if we just bury it in the ground, if we stay off the grid because we don't want to offend anybody, or we don't want to be ridiculed or persecuted, and we think we're good servants because we just give back what he gave us with no return, no fruit, he's going to be very angry with us. And we don't have to live like that. It's not unreasonable for what he's asking of us. It's very reasonable, and it should be our happy privilege to do so. It's a joy to serve the Lord. It's a joy to serve him because of what he's done for us. He gave his life for us. Sacrificed himself on the cross. Easter's coming up, you know. And our minds are already turning to this, that the fact that he became the sacrifice for us. He gained victory over death, so we don't have to fear it. And if we're not afraid of death, then we can live with even more joy as we await his return. Are you ready for him to come back? Are you working while he's coming back? We sang that hymn last week, didn't we? We'll work till Jesus comes. Wasn't just last week we sang that? Remember those words. We'll work till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered home.